Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune, and our first film is a winner. It's the romantic comedy White Man Can't Jump, and this picture is to playground basketball what the fine movie Bull Durham was to minor league baseball. Funny and wise about the sport, and funny and wise about the boyish men who play it. Both films were written and directed by the same talented person, Ron Shelton. At the center of White Men Can't Jump, two basketball hustlers, one black, played by Wesley Snipes from Jungle Fever, one white, Woody Harrelson from Cheers. When they first meet, Harrelson hustles Snipes, pretending to be oafish.
Hey, no. Ain't no need for none of that Jane Fonda geriatric booth. You just come on out here, act like you can play some D. Two quick ones, bam. Go, see ya. Wouldn't want to be. Y'all got a new teammate. Your game, goodbye. Huh? You loose now? Loose? All right, let's play ball, baby. Come on out here, baby. Let's teach you something. Take your suit. I got it. Get the fuck out of here. Well, Billy, I'm going to tell you what. Right? Oh, where you at, Billy? Come with me. Billy, I'm going to tell you something. Go. We'll go that way, right? Huh? Right? I see you a hacker, huh? Where you going, huh? I got you. Where you going? I'm right here. What you got? Show me what you got. Where you going? This is my court.
Eventually, they join forces and start to work their hustles together, pretending they don't know each other.
I let you pick my teammate. How's that?
I don't believe this, man.
$500, baby, and you can pick anybody out here. Anybody.
I don't believe it.
So Raymond, man, look at the chump, man. Give him the chump.
Off the court, White Men Can't Jump is just as good, as both men have problems hanging on to the women in their lives. For example, Woody Harrelson's character owes big gambling money to thugs. His girlfriend, very well played by the gutsy Rosie Perez from Do the Right Thing, wants him to act more responsibly.
We still owe the Spooky Brothers $7,194.
Hey, we don't give them a dime if you ask me. They're holding you up.
Oh, Billy, I mean, how many times do we have to go through this, huh? In life, there are certain things that just are the way they are, and nothing's going to get rid of the Spooky Brothers except $7,000 more.
I really like Rosie Perez. She steals every scene she's in. She has that unmistakable nasal voice, and she is playing the same strong character she played so well in Do the Right Thing, the woman wronged, drawn to a man who acts like a boy. And to its credit, White Men Can't Jump has the richness to include a character like hers amid all the basketball action and comedy. I really enjoyed this movie.
I loved her, too. And, of course, Tyra Farrow plays Wesley Snipes' wife. And what's interesting about both of these men and their women is that these characters are not your standard-issue Hollywood arrested adolescents with their cheap little jokes and their shallow motivations. These are grown men. One of them is playing basketball because times are hard and he's out of work. Yeah. The other one is a compulsive gambler. Their women are trying to deal with this. So it's about real human issues that are played out on the basketball court instead of just a one-dimensional basketball movie.
Well, they are juvenile in their behavior. Yeah. But they're not cookie-cutter comedy characters who have only that one quality to them. The women are really good in this picture. The only thing that I liked, the only thing that was ordinary in the picture, the plot of him having this gambling habit and the thugs that are chasing him, that seems sort of stereotyped.
But the thugs are handled with a certain freshness, and the movie doesn't end quite exactly the way you think it's going to end. And this Ron Shelton, who wrote and directed it, his dialogue is like music. When these guys go nose to nose and start insulting each other, they don't just use every other insult you've ever heard.
Right.
They come up with dozens of new ones, and there's an exhilaration just in listening to them talk to each other.
It's a terrific movie.
Okay, now we have another sports movie, The Cutting Edge, and this one is about figure skating at the Olympics level, and like White Men Can't Jump, it stars a couple of actors who are also accomplished athletes and make the movie a lot more convincing by doing, or certainly seeming to do, all of their own skating. The movie stars Maura Kelly as a spoiled rich girl who may be the best figure skater in the world and is certainly the most obnoxious. She's gone through one partner after another, and finally in desperation, her father and her coach come up with this hockey player who may have no figure skating experience, but at least will be tough enough for her. He's played by D.B. Sweeney.
Oh, my God.
What, my hand?
Well, what do? Soak them in battery acid?
Oh, I know they're a little rough, but I've never had any complaints before.
Oh, I'm terribly impressed. What is this? Final stages of Ukrainian alcohol psychosis?
Sweeney was raised in a hockey family which had nothing but contempt for figure skaters. This is a new and threatening world for him. And, of course, inevitably, their hostility is mixed with a little flirtation.
So what do you do for fun? Polish your knife collection?
I'm sure there's nothing I do that you'd find exciting. I don't open beer bottles with my toes. I don't sit around and count what's left of my teeth. Hey, I don't even enjoy a good tractor pull. It's been a limited existence, but I've gotten used to it.
Life of the party, huh? Place must be crawling with guys.
The general pattern of the cutting edge is familiar by now from countless other sports movies. You're going to have two intersecting curves. As the two skaters get better on the ice, their personal relationship also develops until they get to be terrific on the ice and also fall in love. And then at that point, of course, both their skating and their romantic life begins to go to pieces. The movie's not original, and it lacks the wonderful kinetic energy of White Men Can't Jump. But on the other hand, the figure skating sequences are fun to look at, and Kelly and Sweeney have nice acting chemistry. I like them in this movie. So whether you like this movie or not may depend to some extent on how much you like figure skating. I'm not that much of a figure skating fan, so I'm going to give it kind of a marginal thumbs down.
Well, that comes out of the blue. You haven't said anything negative about the film except that it's about figure skating.
I think I said something else negative, which was that it was an entirely formula picture.
Okay. Well, I thought you were going to say thumbs up, which I give the picture. I liked it, and I liked it for the same reason that you say you did like it. I thought that the two characters were absolutely charming. Mm-hmm. I think this is sort of patterned a little bit after Dirty Dancing.
Yeah.
It's like Dirty Dancing on ice, and I think that they're fun together. The scenes are standard. I mean, we know that we've seen all of these scenes before, but they're very well played, and I would give it the benefit of the doubt.
To not even have to go to another week's movies, but just to look at White Men Can't Jump and seeing how that sports movie, which also involves these two people and their shifting relationship, is so much more original and so much fresher than this.
If you're asking,
it seems to me there is a gap between these two movies that your thumb ought to somehow reflect.
No, I just think one is very good. I actually called it terrific, and one is passably good, and I give this picture thumbs up marginally. Coming up next, the power of one young man's epic battle to combat racism in South Africa.
A waterfall begins with only one drop of water, sir. Look what comes from that.
You're asking me to break that law, and possibly jeopardize the survival of the school.
You've taught us that inclusion, not exclusion, is the key to survival, sir. How will they ever be included if they can't read or write English?
That's Stephen Dorff playing a young white man who dedicates his life to battling racism in South Africa in The Power of One. And this obviously is a well-intentioned film, but one that I think gets out of hand as a movie, making this kid into a national hero. Rocky director John Avildsen directs The Power of One, and maybe that's why the kid comes across as such a mythic movie figure. The story begins in the 1930s as the boy, a South African of English parentage, loses his father. He becomes strengthened by a meeting with a medicine man. Another influence, a well-educated German man named Doc, played by Armin Mueller-Stahl.
In school, you will get all filled up with facts. Out here, your brain will learn where to look and how to think.
And years later, during World War II, another influence is a black African played by Morgan Freeman.
Want to be a boxer?
I think I'm too little.
Two of us. Not to worry, clean bus. Little beat big when little smart. First with the head, then with the heart.
After all this tutoring, the kid does some teaching of his own in a very awkward scene, teaching different tribesmen to sing together. Intended, I suppose, as a metaphor, this scene smacks of white paternalism. Again, the goals of The Power of One are noble, but I didn't find the story inspiring. I thought it was awkward and simplistic as a movie. Director John Avildsen also made The Karate Kid, and we have the same kind of training a kid to do good story here, but the journey in South Africa is a lot more tricky than this film allows.
I agree with you. I found the early parts of the film to be quite interesting and quite beautiful in terms of its photography and the land that they show us and the reality that they show us, and then the movie loses its way, and it turns, first of all, into a boxing movie,
yeah.
And then as the neo-Nazi little kid who taunted him in school turns up again later, we can tell by the same tattoo, he's now a policeman, and it becomes a conflict between these two people at the end. This isn't about South Africa anymore. It's about who's going to win the violent confrontation at the climax of the film, and that's the same standard cookie-cutter ending you get at the beginning, at the end of every cop movie, every urban thriller. South Africa is completely lost by the end of this
film.
Well,
that's where I think Avildsen in the Rocky and the Karate Kid hedges his bets, and I think he makes it into his, you know, movie story where you have a fight mm-hmm. leading to a rooting interest, and the issues are lost, and the complexity of the issues is lost in
the
story.
Yeah, the movie completely fudges it. At the end of the film, not to give anything away, but apparently something is resolved, but actually in life, what happened during that same year was that the Afrikaners took power, and we're in power ever since, right up to the present moment. So the movie kind of leaves you with a happy ending that isn't quite borne out by the history books. When we come back, Danny Aiello plays Ruby, the man who shot Lee Harvey Oswald.
Have you been using me for a patsy?
A long engagement at the Sands Hotel in Las Vegas, Nevada. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Candy Kane.
Danny Aiello plays Jack Ruby there, introducing his latest striptease discovery in his Dallas nightclub. And that's in Ruby, a new movie about the man who shot Lee Harvey Oswald. If Aiello seems too tall and muscular to be Jack Ruby in the movie, that's only part of the problem. He's also too charismatic, too confident, and too self-contained in a screen portrait that flatters Ruby at the same time that it adds almost nothing to our knowledge of why he shot Oswald. In the film, Ruby is a low-level mafioso from Chicago who moves to Dallas, opens a strip club, and begins to make local contacts, including some with people whose connections are even shadier than his own.
What is it with you people? You're the ones that not me. You blew it in Cuba. That's what you did. You hired the boys to kill Castro.
According to the movie, Ruby was somehow the dupe of both the mob and the CIA, even while knowing almost nothing himself.
I got this guy Maxwell on my back. This Castro thing is killing everything.
You get the CIA off of my back.
Castro? Forget Castro. Castro's history.
What?
You changed our plans. We're out of Cuba.
As is always the case in movies about the assassination of Kennedy, the historic scenes themselves create unsettling echoes in our memories. These kinds of scenes always seem to work. At the end, Ruby protests that he had his reasons for killing Oswald, but they remain obscure.
All of Dallas says I'm a hero. I'll walk, Frank.
Ruby is sort of a shaggy dog story in that it creates a lot of suspicious circumstances around Jack Ruby, but when he finally pulls the trigger, it's hard to see what they had to do with anything. The character of the stripper, played by Sherilyn Finn from Twin Peaks, is fascinating until we find out in the end credits that she's completely fictional. Ruby seems fictional here, too, a basically nice guy who would have been the dupe of a conspiracy he never understood if he hadn't happened to act on his own anyway. This movie is in release at about the same time as JFK, but it doesn't deserve to be on the same double bill. It's more of a fanciful footnote.
Yeah, I was completely uninterested in the film, and I love, you know, the story is obviously compelling, but
yeah.
I didn't think I learned anything special about it, and I thought that actually the film was pretty much a tease to its big payoff scene when we see the reenactment of Ruby walking down the Dallas Police Quarter basement. Now, at that point in this movie, I haven't had anything to justify the import of that sequence. I don't know why he is, specifically why he is there.
Why he's doing it.
And then I think the most interesting chapter in Jack Ruby's life would be those many years after that killing before he dies. Mm-hmm. Now, why wouldn't the film want to dramatize that and investigate that? I thought that would have been fascinating.
They kind of touch on why he's afraid to testify unless he's
But just
given...
touch on it.
Yeah, that is interesting. This was based on a play that was originally produced in London, and I think the purpose of the play might have been to create a character named Jack Ruby who was interesting, and Danny Aiello and the filmmakers do succeed in doing that, but at the cost of any connection with the real Jack Ruby or with the real shooting of Lee Harvey Oswald. I wound up liking the character, but saying, gee, it doesn't have anything to do with what happened in Dallas
But a better character, similar character, is the last half of Raging Bull, where you have Robert De Niro playing a similar kind of character.
Sure.
Nightclub impresario, and his character is much more fascinating. Right. So even on that basis,
pick the best movie of the last 12 years as your example. But coming up next, Michael Caine has an all-star cast in the comedy Noises Off.
Sorry, I thought you said something to me.
Yes, just go and hit the box office manager with this, and you'll have finished off live theater in Des Moines, Iowa.
Our next movie is Noises Off, based on the spectacularly funny English stage comedy that also was a smash on Broadway. About a frustrated director leading a troupe of bumbling theater actors through their paces in a riotous farce. A farce is the play that they're playing, and a farce is what they make of it. I saw the play in London, loved it in London, but I don't think it works that well on film. This is one of those classic farces of characters walking in and out of doors and into each other. A very physical high-wire act that loses something transferred to film, where the movie starts and stops with its editing. For example, this scene where Michael Caine, as the director, rehearses his actors. They have a problem. The bombshell in the cast, Nicolette Sheridan, has lost a contact lens.
Brook, love, is this going to happen during the performance? We don't want the audience to miss their last buses and trains.
She'll just keep going, won't you, sweetie?
But can she see anything without them?
Can she hear anything without them?
Sorry!
Sorry!
Ow!
Sorry, girl! You stepped on his ham!
When the play is on, the mistakes get bigger and more embarrassing, usually involving such old standbys as unbuttoned pants.
Darling, where have you been? I've been going mad. Look at the state I'm in.
The second act of the movie is filmed principally from backstage while an actual performance of the play is going on. Here's a virtual pantomime sequence involving one actor, Denholm Elliott, plays a drunkard, and others who are feuding lovers, Carol Burnett and John Ritter.
Being a tax exile?
Revenue, they hear us.
No. What?
Oh, I see it. If that's
what
Mark is
called,
I shall never know.
Listen,
you give me a turn, my awesome quite out of me,
Bill.
He thought you were. I thought you was in fight.
We are.
You haven't seen us.
We're not here.
All right, then, love, you're not here. I haven't seen anybody ask for you. I don't know nothing.
While watching that scene on film, I felt distanced from the action. It's like the filmmakers made it happen, which of course they did. On stage, one is amazed to see that kind of scene played out in real time. It's the difference between watching a magician live or watching him on film. Another thing, I didn't care for the all-star casting of this movie. It made the whole affair seem much more planned and concocted rather than watching more anonymous actors on stage. They would seem more at risk than, say, Carol Burnett.
Well, you know, I wonder if it wasn't one of my problems that I saw this play three times on the stage. I thought it was so funny.
It's wonderful.
And so, essentially, the screenplay of the movie is the play as seen
pretty
on
much.
The stage. Very few differences, except for that little narration by Michael Caine. And so I knew basically what was going to happen, but also you put your finger right on it. When real people are making split-second moves on stage in a play that for three acts is nothing but nonstop, breathless action. Okay. It's very funny intrinsically. When you see it in a movie where there are cuts, where there are
angles
and so forth, and where you know that there are different shots that are being done, the peculiar magic of that kind of choreography is completely lost, and I didn't think it was that funny.
No, I didn't either. When we come back, our video pick of the week, also starring Michael Caine and Christopher Reeve.
And now it's time for the video pick of the week, and watching Michael Caine with Christopher Reeve in the movie Noises Off reminded me of another movie about show business that they starred in together almost 10 years ago. It's the 1983 thriller comedy called Death Trap, with Caine as a successful Broadway playwright who hasn't written an original word in years, and Reeve as the struggling newcomer. Caine immediately realizes Reeve's new play is brilliant, and he schemes to steal it. He's quite prepared to even kill Reeve if necessary. Death Trap, like Noises Off, began life as a play. It was written by Ira Levin. It was filmed by Sidney Lumet as sort of a wind-up machine to make us laugh, to scare us, and to completely mislead us. It's not a great movie, but on that level, it does work. And the two actors have a lot of fun in a screenplay that is essentially an extended dueling match between them. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two very enthusiastic thumbs up for White Men Can't Jump, the very funny, very smart new comedy starring Wesley Snipes and Woody Harrelson. A split decision on The Cutting Edge, the figure skating romance. We both found the characters attractive, but Gene liked the movie more than I did. Two thumbs down for The Power of One, the South African film that begins promisingly but loses its way and turns into a boxy movie and an action film. two more thumbs down for Ruby, which told us less about Jack Ruby than we already knew. And two more thumbs down for Noises Off, which we loved on the stage, but didn't like as a movie. And the real discovery this week, especially for people who think they might not want to see a basketball movie, right, is White Men Can't Jump.
And the two discoveries within that film are Ron Shelton, the writer-director. He was not a one-time wonder with Bull Durham. This is a terrific job by him. And also Rosie Perez. You know, it's Oscar time. Why can't she get an Oscar nomination? Supporting actor, she's terrific.
Think she'll have to wait for next year, Jane. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of some more new movies, including Thunderheart, starring Val Kilmer in a murder mystery set on a Native American reservation, and Straight Talk, a romantic comedy starring Dolly Parton and James Woods. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
No-nonsense pantyhose, as beautifully put together as the women who wear them. No-nonsense. It's America's favorite jelly bean, Jelly Belly, now appearing at theaters and video stores with good taste. Jelly Belly beans, try them, you'll love them. Shower yourself with a new sensation, new refreshing shield. Experience its unique skin-vigorating formula and feel the blast of pure refreshment. Sergio Tacchini, European-designed activewear, tennis wear, and athletic shoes in the latest fabrics and colors, furnished by Sergio Tacchini.